Well, good morning, everyone. My name's Hank Vandenbruggen, and I'm elder of Blessings Christian Church. You'll notice I'm not wearing green today, but we are here to worship the Lord. And it's my sincere pleasure to welcome all of you this morning. We offer a special welcome to guests and, of course, visitors and online viewers. And, of course, if you're here for the first time, we acknowledge your courage. It's not easy to walk into a church building for the first time. But we're so happy that you're here, and we pray that you'll feel truly welcomed and at home. You'll notice that our ushers are wearing blue lanyards. They can be found at the back of the church, upstairs, downstairs. They can answer most of your questions. They can direct you. They can find you a washroom, whatever you may require. If you are a guest and you'd like to get to know us a little better, I would encourage you to fill out a visitor information card. You'll find them in the back of your chair or in your pew upstairs. You can pass a card to me or one of the ushers after the service. If you're watching at home, where you would rather not fill out a card, then you can also reach us via email at info@blessingshamilton.ca. We have a prayer team. We are a praying church. At the conclusion of this service, prayer volunteers will be available at the front near the pulpit here at the blue banner, or purple banner, I guess it is. If you carry a burden on your heart, or if you wish to share something sad or something joyous in your life, please come to the Purple Banner after church, and there'll be someone there willing to pray with you, for you. If you'd rather not come up, by all means, email our prayer-team@blessingshamilton.ca, and they'll pray for you at home. After the service, we have a delicious lunch served downstairs, especially for visitors. Of course, members are also welcome. I'm also asked to announce that there's a meeting of YAC this morning. That's an 18 to 24-year-old, so YAC stands for Young Adult Collective. They'll be meeting after the service downstairs. And then, of course, I would like to introduce to you our preacher today, and it's my sincere pleasure to welcome Pastor Phil Tadros. He'll be standing up here shortly. Pastor Phil, is assistant pastor for church planting at New City Church, the PCA church around the corner. He's currently gathering and training a group from both their mother church and from East Hamilton and Stony Creek, I believe. And they hope to begin services in the fall. Now, about 8 days a month, you may still find Phil flying a Boeing 767. As a cargo pilot, and he flies out of Hamilton Airport. He's married to Lindsay. Is Lindsay here today, too? She didn't? Okay. And together they have 4 children, and we welcome Pastor Phil. Welcome. And may the Lord bless you with a large measure of his spirit this morning. Please rise for the call to worship. Clap your hands, all people. Shout to God with loud songs of joy.
The Lord Most High is awesome, the Creator over all the earth.
God has gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sounds of a trumpet.
Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises to our King, sing praises.
As we repeated that 3 times, we're going to sing 3 songs. Come, let us worship and bow down. Come, thou fount, come, thou King, and Lord, from sorrow's deep I call.
Worship and bow down. Let us sing. The fires have all grown cold.
As we're gathered here in worship, let us lift up our hearts to the Lord. So at this time in our worship service, we usually read or reflect on the law of God, and we come to the Lord with a prayer of confession. This morning, I would like to do this by praying together using the framework of Psalm 19, the Psalm of David. In this prayer, there will be an opportunity to confess your own private and perhaps secret sins to Almighty God. Shall we pray? Almighty, holy God, may your name be hallowed. Father, in this Psalm 19, we read that the heavens declare your glory and the skies proclaim the work of your hands. Father, even those who may never have heard of you can't miss it. We confess that day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge. They have no actual speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them. And yet, their message can't be missed. The beauty of your creation is everywhere. Yes, Father, their message has gone throughout the earth and their words to all the world. In the heavens, you have pitched a tent for the sun. It bursts forth like a radiant bridegroom after his wedding, like a champion rejoicing to run his course. It rises at one end of the heavens and follows its course to the other end. Nothing is deprived of its warmth. Nothing can hide from its heat. And we too are allowed to bask in its warmth, and we too may declare that your law is perfect, and that your law refreshes the soul. We know that your commandments are trustworthy and make the simple wise. We confess that your precepts, O Lord, are not only right, but beautiful, giving joy to the heart. Your commands, O Lord, are clear, giving insight for living. Teach us, O Lord, that reverence for you is pure, lasting forever. Teach us that your laws are firm and all of them are fair, that they're more desirable than gold, than much pure gold, that they're sweeter than honey from the honeycomb. It is by your commandments that we are warned and told that in keeping them there is a great reward. Without your commandments, we would not even know what sin is. Without your law, we could not truly tell right from wrong. You teach us your perfect law, and yet we just sang, the thorn remains. Because who can keep your law perfectly? And so we confess that we cannot keep any of your commandments perfectly at all, and that we've sinned again and again. Father, hear us now as we individually confess our public and secret sins to you in this moment of corporate silence. Father, keep us from willful sins, and we pray today that they may not control us. Father, together with your servant David, we pray that these words of our mouth and this meditation of our heart may be pleasing to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Hear us in the name of Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah. He who kept your law perfectly. He who did what we could not and cannot do. He who paid for all our debts. It's in his name alone that we put our hope. Amen. So the children are now invited to go downstairs to join their respective children's programs. While we prepare to sing Psalm 16 as our song of response, following this song, Tom will come up and do the scripture reading for us. He will read Psalm 16, and after that, Pastor Phil will preach God's word to us.
Our Bible reading this morning is taken also from Psalm 16, which is a psalm of David. Keep me safe, my God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing. I say of the holy people who are in the land, they are the noble ones in whom is all my delight. Those who run after other gods will suffer more and more. I will not pour out libations of blood to such gods or take their names on my lips. Lord, you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body will also rest secure because you will not abandon me to the realms of the dead. Nor will you let your faithful one decay. You will make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, good morning, Blessings Church. It is a great privilege and delight to be with you on this Lord's Day and to share from God's holy word with you. Our text this morning is the Gospel of John, chapter 12. I invite you to go there. I will begin our time together by reading from the words of John 12, verses 1 to 11. Six days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Here, a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served, while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with him. Then Mary took about a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume. She poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected. Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth a year's wages. He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. As keeper of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. Leave her alone, Jesus replied. It was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me. Meanwhile, a large crowd of Jews found out that Jesus was there and came, not only because of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to kill Lazarus as well. For on account of him, many of the Jews were going over to Jesus and believing in him. This is God's holy and inerrant word. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, apart from you, these are just words, but these are words that you inspired so that through them we might behold Jesus Christ. Would you open our eyes this morning that we might see Jesus, so that we might see wonderful things from your word? Lord, we want to meet with you this morning. And so use me, a weak vessel, so that, Lord, we might see just how excellent and wonderful and beautiful you are, Jesus, and how worthy you are of our worship and of our devotion. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. As many of you know, last week was March break. And even though our kids are homeschooled, they had the opportunity to spend some time with friends from our church. The kids decided to put on a little show for us grown-ups, a little performance. And while I'm not much into pop culture, it didn't take long for me to realize that this was a love story song by one called Taylor Swift. And I was struck and somewhat disturbed by the level of devotion and passion with which my children sang. Now, I assure you, I am no Swiftie, not even close. But it got me thinking about the celebrity craze that's going on right now. Just the kind of over-the-top devotion that people can develop for these larger-than-life celebrities. And as I was asking my wife, Lindsay, about this, she said, did you know that people camp out online on Ticketmaster.com, refreshing, clicking, and waiting for that second that they can buy that one precious ticket to go see the celebrity? I looked it up, and she was right. To get floor seats so he can sit at the feet of T.S. herself, seats were sold last year for as much as $17,100 in Arizona and $35,438 in Atlanta. It got my attention even more when one Canadian young adult in Edmonton decided to save a year's worth of her wages so she can fly from Edmonton to Toronto just to sit at the feet of T.S. That's devotion, folks. In an article, she's reporting to say, in her words, "I think it's sure worth it, and I would save a year in advance for this." So she put away money from every paycheck for a whole year so she could go see Taylor Swift. Now, why in the world am I telling you all of this? Because we know a thing or two about sacrificing and saving and setting aside money and time and resources for the things that we love, for the things that we want to buy, for the career that promises satisfaction. We know how to set our affections on things, sometimes to the point of fixation and obsession. We're willing to sacrifice a great deal, too, for what is often fleeting and temporary. We might shake our heads at Swifties, but the truth is that deep down, we are all Swifties in one way, shape, or form. Because Swifties set their extravagant and devoted attention and affection on what will pass away. But in this morning's texts, we see someone who is actually worthy of our affections. And we meet one of his disciples, Mary of Bethany, who was convinced that Jesus is so worthy. And she shows that it's a beautiful thing to love him and follow him with all your heart, and even to pour all that you have at his feet. And both Jesus and the Apostle John agreed. Now, John Piper has written this sentence that really caught my attention. He says, "It is a beautiful thing when the worth of Jesus and the love of his followers match. When the value of his perfections and the intensity of our affections correspond." Then he says this thing that caught my attention, referring to Judas. He says, "And when our affections don't correspond to Jesus' beauty and worth, it can be suicidal." I invite you to come into the story with me to see what he is talking about and why the Gospel of John reported the story for us. First, I want us to consider Mary's devotion. Let me set the scene for us. This is the last scene before Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. We are 2 miles away from the holy city of Jerusalem in a small village called Bethany. This was one of Jesus' favorite places to go when he was in New Jerusalem. Now, an amazing miracle has just taken place. Lazarus, who had been dead and entombed for 4 days, did come forth. He was dead, and Jesus brought him back to life because Jesus is the resurrection and the life. And if you know anything about the Gospel of John, Jesus, the Son of God, has been calling people. He has been the light dispelling the darkness of sin and unbelief and death. And we're at the point in the story where we're at a climax. Men and women, says one commentator, are being forced to choose which side is theirs. Jesus is urging them to join the kingdom of God. "Put your trust in the light," he says, while you have it, so that you may become sons of light. Well, Lazarus rising from the dead caused many of the Jews to follow Jesus. And just before our passage this morning, at the very end of chapter 11, we see that this is a tipping point. The Pharisees and religious leaders have had enough. They now make plans to put Jesus to death. A public notice and orders have been given that if anyone knew, verse 57 of chapter 11, if anyone knew where Jesus was, he should let them know so that they might arrest him. So that's where we're at in the story. And chapter 12 is that transition before the last week of Jesus' life, the most important week in human history. It's the Sabbath evening before Palm Sunday. And Jesus has not been seen in public for some time. Now he's in Bethany, last stop before he goes into Jerusalem. Jesus has set his face to go into Jerusalem where he will die. Things are tense There's conspiracy and intrigue as a result of the orders from the religious authorities. Jerusalem, which is not far away, there's multitudes of people coming from all over the inhabited world, descending upon Jerusalem for the great festival of Passover. And this is the time where either devotion or antagonism to Jesus will be displayed. And so in the village that day, to celebrate that amazing miracle, Lazarus and his two sisters, Martha and Mary, are hosting a special party, a banquet, in honor of Jesus. And while the meal is taking place, and Martha is serving, as she always did, and Lazarus is sitting at the table beside Jesus, something remarkable happens. Mary, who loved to sit at Jesus' feet, to hear him teach and to enjoy his presence, walks in, breaks a very expensive jar, pours out 1 pound of expensive ointment, perfume, on Jesus. She's anointing him the way that special guests and dignitaries in times of old would be anointed, kings and people who were important. John says she anoints his feet with this expensive perfume. First thing I want us to notice this morning is Mary's act is one of devotion to Jesus. Everybody in that scene is focused not on Jesus or on Mary's affection, but on other things. Mary has offended just about everyone in that room. For a moment, if you can imagine with me, for a moment, you can hear a pin drop. People begin to whisper, and the whispers begin to give way to complaints. Can you believe this is happening? What is she thinking? And why is that? Because Mary's devotion seems, indeed is, extravagant and over the top. First, consider the cost of the perfume. This was not some old-fashioned perfume. This was special stuff, pure, extracted, and important from the Indian Himalayas. That's what pure nard is. It may have been a family heirloom. Usually people preserve that kind of expensive ointment for marriage dowries or for their own burials. Please understand, this is not an impulsive act on the part of Mary. She didn't just walk randomly into the room and decide willy-nilly to pour this out. She's been sitting at Jesus' feet. She's been hearing him teach. She loves her master. She knows his worth. She has tasted the bread of life. She has seen the light of the world. He has become her good shepherd, and she has seen him raise her own brother. She knows what he's worth. She knows that he is the bread of heaven who will soon give his flesh for the life of the world. Mary is not silly or impulsive. She has preserved this for a purpose, and Jesus says that. She's preserved this for a purpose, for a particular occasion, and she decides that the time is now to express the worth of Jesus. Now, it's not always the time for extravagance, is it? It's not always the time for over-the-top devotion, but Mary grasps the significance of what's about to happen, and she thinks the time is now. To her, as one commentator says, Jesus is no casual run-of-the-mill guest. For him, a very costly offering is just right. In verse 5, we're given an idea of just how expensive this ointment is. It was equivalent to a year's worth of wages. So if we want to put a round figure on, it would have been about 50,000 to 60,000 Canadian dollars today. It's a lot. Mary doesn't just dab Jesus with a little bit of it. She breaks the alabaster jar, which itself would have been of significant value, and anoints Jesus with all 11 ounces of perfume. If you know anything about perfume, 11 ounces is a lot of perfume. It's a lavish, over-the-top quantity. I decided to Google the most expensive perfumes in the world. And there's a perfume called Clive Christian No. 1 Imperial Majesty. And as I read the description, I began to wonder if people felt that way about pure nard in Jesus' day. Listen to the marketed description of this perfume. This is a sophisticated scent for women who want a perfume that is both weightless and enchanting. The scent is of a light Tahitian vanilla with a hint of rose centifolia that is reminiscent of the goddess of love and beauty, Aphrodite. I guess they knew what Aphrodite smelled like. At the heart of the perfume is ylang ylang, and will give women a sense of wearing a perfect diamond necklace around their neck. This perfume today sells for $12,972 per ounce. Outrageous. Extravagant. And Mary did something very similar. She poured all of that at Jesus' feet without holding back. And to her, it's not a waste, but an expression of Jesus' supreme and satisfying worth. Second, Mary takes the most humble posture to show her affection to Jesus. She takes the posture of what? A servant, a slave. In the ancient Middle East, and still today, feet are the dirtiest and most untouchable parts of a human being. People still wear open sandals, commonly, in part of the world that I come from, in Egypt. It was even the right of servants not to touch and clean their master's dirty feet. That was just too unpleasant. Even servants were allowed to say no to that. Some people today romanticize the washing of feet. I was once at a wedding where I helped officiate, and the couple chose to wash each other's feet. It's very romantic. It's very sentimental. But, you know, they washed their feet and took a nice bath before the wedding. Jesus' feet would have been dirty. Mary placed herself in the meanest and lowest place and took the posture of the vilest, the weakest, and the poor. Because she knows that Jesus is abounding in mercy for her and will soon take her place. He will take her place, that of the weakest, the vilest, and the poor. And he will hang on a cross as an object of shame and contempt in a place that doesn't smell good. In fact, in the garbage dump of the city, he will go there and bear Mary's shame and guilt and sin and yours and mine. And he will exchange it for his righteousness and his glory. And so she anoints him as the suffering king who will take the meanest place. And to add insult to injury, she wipes his feet with her hair. Again, in ancient times and still today, think about hair. A woman's beautiful hair is her glory. It's a prized and valued possession. And it was a mark of loose morals to undo one's hair in public. Only one kind of woman did that. So Mary is also displaying courageous devotion to show her loyalty to Jesus. She says, I'm with him. With her hair loose at Jesus' feet, she kneels down on the ground. She wipes off the oil with her soft hair in an act of adoration and homage. It's as if she says, my hair is the most beautiful and the most clean thing I have. But if it could serve to magnify your glory and your sweetness, it would be my honor to turn it into a rag for your feet. She gets it. In contrast with the treatment that King Jesus is about to receive from the authorities, she opens herself up to charges of immorality and shame in order to magnify Jesus with her honor. With honor. And soon Jesus will indeed take away all of her shame. Well, folks, this is not just an over-the-top, wasteful, extravagant, perhaps, but even more, it's scandalous. And John gives us a sense of that in verse 3 at the end. He says, the house is filled with the fragrance of the perfume. It sounds like an eyewitness was there, doesn't it? You get a sense that a nose witness is even speaking. Somebody who was there and smelled that aroma, that fragrance of so much perfume filling a room. When I was a child, I was a bit naughty. And one time I broke a small little cologne jar that my grandmother had. And it was like maybe an ounce. And I remember that the smell of it was poignant for days. You can smell it for days afterward. It filled the air. It is something about smells. The poet Rudyard Kipling has a line that came to mind. Smells are surer than sounds or sights to make your heartstrings crack. Well, the house that had recently been filled with mourning and the smell of death's decay from Lazarus is now filled with what? With fragrance. A smell of grateful love and devotion to Jesus. Well, to others in the room, it was not a lovely fragrance. It was a nauseous fragrance. Most, in fact, in the room. It takes one verse to describe Mary's adoring and courageous act of devotion and three verses to describe the decay that comes with sin's deceit. Enter Judas in verses 4 to 6. I'll read it for you again. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, said, "Why was this ointment not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?" And he said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. And having charge of the money bag, he used to skim a little off the top, help himself to what was put in it. Now, before we heap abuse upon Judas, please consider how rational and thoughtful he is. It's a reasonable objection to a courageous, to an outrageous act. He says 300 denarii, as you'll probably see in your Bible's footnotes, is a year's worth of wages. And he has pious concerns. He says this represents a lot of money. It could have been given as alms to the poor. It's all now just a big waste, isn't it? Well, we know Judas had the appearance of piety, but behind the scenes, he was actually self-serving. He acted like he was concerned for the poor, but that calculating, analyzing spirit that he was displaying betrayed a deceit in his heart. Mary's outrageous devotion served to actually show what was really going on in Judas's heart. Now, somehow he was disappointed with Jesus by this point. He had been straying from him, enthralled by power and influence and money, we're told in this passage, instead of what Jesus had really come to do. He had, in fact, been pilfering money from the money bank. And instead of using it to provide for Jesus and the disciples and for the poor, he was using it for himself. Now, this points us to something tragic and something that should sober us, that it is possible for us to go about doing good things and be really, really close to Jesus. To go to Jesus things and do Jesus things and go to church and be really close publicly with Jesus, identifying with him, and do good causes in our homes and work and occupations and sit on business boards and church boards and committees and so on, but do all of that from self-serving motives. The heart is deceitful above all things, says Jeremiah, desperately sick. Sometimes we cloak our activities with a veneer of religiosity, and sometimes we don't even try. But we are operating not out of a true self, an authentic self that's devoted to Jesus, but out of a false self that we've created or manufactured, trying to fit in some role, trying to fulfill some social expectations, perhaps. Or even just trying to look like someone else that we like. D.A. Carson laments that things like social activism, and even, I want to add, things like Bible study even, and theological inquiry, even that which meets real needs sometimes masks a spirit that knows nothing of worship and adoration. Well, that will not do for Jesus. Jesus wants followers who worship him in spirit and in truth, out of a genuine encounter of his soul-satisfying worth. This is what makes us more like Jesus. And Judas is on the opposite trajectory. His heart had been decaying over time by the deceitfulness of sin, layer upon layer of contempt and disregard and superficial hearing of the words of Jesus, until his heart sank under the weight of sin, deceit, and betrayal of Jesus. He didn't just wake up one morning and betray him. One commentator says, can we just see a glimpse of him even for a moment as we look in the mirror? Sobering stuff. Mark reports that after this incident, he was ready to betray Jesus for 30 pieces of silver and deliver him to die. J.C. Ryle, the Anglican bishop of the 18th century, says, from the highest degree of privilege to the lowest depth of sin, there is but a succession of steps. Privileges misused seem to paralyze the conscience. He says, the same fire that melts wax hardens clay. I hate to talk about Judas, but I feel like I must. How did Judas get here? Judas, I think, was in love with the world, especially money. The love of the Father didn't fill his heart. One commentator, Henderson, says Judas was the type of man who always had money on his mind. He views everything from the aspect of monetary value. Mary views everything from the aspect of Jesus' value and worth. Judas loved money more than Jesus. He was deceived by its value. And this morning, as by way of application, I want us to expose that idol of money for what it is. James Duguid writes, says, money is not God. It can't raise the dead. It can't love you back. Money is meant to represent value. It's currency. We gain money for what we provide or for what we do. Then we exchange it for the reward we gained, for things that we need or want. But money will not shepherd us. It won't take care of us. It won't teach us truth. Money will not give itself in your place. Money is not at the right hand of God interceding for you. Money will not give you the righteousness that you so badly need to be justified before God. Mary understood this, but Judas doesn't. Judas didn't. Money is a mean to an end, but Jesus is the end in himself. And so Paul in 1 Timothy reminds us, he says, we brought nothing into the world and we will take nothing out of the world. If we have food and clothing, he says, well, these we will be content. But listen, those who desire, those who want to be rich, fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all evils. It is through this craving that some, O Judas, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many pangs. Friends, watch over your heart and let those who love you tell you when you seem to be trading your beautiful inheritance in Jesus for a bowl of soup or for a rotten business deal or for sensual and ungodly pleasures. That's why the author to the Hebrews says, take care, brothers and sisters, lest there be in any of you an evil and unbelieving heart leading you to fall away from the living God. We sang about it earlier, prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. And his solution is, but exhort one another every day, be in community. Exhort one another every day as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin, because we've come to share in Christ if we hold our confidence firm to the end. On our own, we are not actually very good at appraising the true value of things. That is why, like Mary, we must regularly sit at Jesus' feet and learn, listen, and grow in our delight and enjoy the means of grace, spiritual disciplines, godly friendships. Because ultimately, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And we must ask ourselves this morning, do my commitments really come out of a heart captivated with Jesus? Do they reflect his kingdom values of mercy and compassion and justice? What will we choose today? These days, after dinner, I've been going through a devotional with my family about different persons in church history, and it highlights the stories of women in the course of church history who have honored Jesus. And we read this last week about Agnès Ogné Bouyadjizo, a girl who devoted her life to displaying the compassion of Jesus. See if you recognize this person. While living in India, it was her habit to rescue dying people from gutters. But the hospital personnel there often refused to admit them. So Agnès demanded a building where she would be able to care for the dying in dignified comfort. No sooner than the hospice had been built, an angry crowd there in the village threatened to tear it down. And fearlessly, she invited the mob's leader into the building to see what she was doing for these poor people. And the man came out and dismissed the mob. And later she reported, she brought in the ministry to include abandoned babies and lepers. Donations poured in. And it was her simple habit to ask when she was collecting money, she would say, "Would you do something beautiful for Jesus?" That was her question. Will you do something beautiful for Jesus? Time magazine described her devotion as outrageous courage. Of course, this woman is Mother Teresa. I'm convinced that it is only from the deep well of living and feeding upon Jesus Christ and walking by his Spirit that we can become salt of the earth and light of the world. That devotion to Jesus will come out not by mere duty, but from delight. I see some young people here. Make Jesus the love of your life from early on, and you will never be disappointed. You will be satisfied in him. Obviously, that goes for all of us. But from early on, just make Jesus the love and the passion of your life, and you will not be disappointed. But if we don't, our souls will be like Judas, shrinking, empty, vulnerable to the deceit of sin. And we will not leave a beautiful fragrance or a legacy behind us. Let's get practical for a minute. How do we grow in our delight and devotion to Jesus? For all of us, I think for most of us, daily devotions is something that we put time into, which is wonderful. But what happens when daily devotions just become a dull duty instead of a delightful practice? Well, here's a really simple tip. Maybe you just happen to be stuck right now in your devotions. In 1535, Martin Luther wrote a short little letter to his barber named Master Peter. You should read it sometime. In which he instructed him in a simple way to pray. He said, "I want your heart to be stirred and guided and rightly warmed and inclined toward prayer." And he advised him every day to read a short passage of scripture and meditate on it. And he said, I just take a small phrase and close your eyes, think about it, mull over it. And he says, "I divide every biblical passage into four parts, a garland of four strands." He asks himself four things. Is there an instruction here for me? Is there something for which I ought to be giving thanks? Is there sin that's being exposed that I must confess? And fourthly, he says, I pray. I just bring it all in a prayer to God. And if I may add to this, I've been doing this lately when I've been stuck in my devotions. Sing. Even if your voice is as bad as mine, just sing. It will stir your soul. You know, the psalmist David sometimes got stuck too. In Psalm 108, he says, "Awake, awake my soul. Awake and smell the beautiful fragrance of Jesus. If you draw near to the Lord, he will draw near to you." Well, as we close, Judas is not happy. And many of the people, Mark tells us in his gospel, many of the people in the room aren't happy. And Jesus speaks up and he says, "Leave her alone so that she may keep it for my burial. For the poor you will always have with you, but you do not always have me." Leave her alone, says Jesus. In Mark's gospel, he reports that Jesus actually adds a little short sentence. "She has done a beautiful thing to me," Jesus says. "A beautiful thing to me. She's anointed me for my burial." Normally, she would have kept this perfume for a special occasion, like her burial, or for someone else, or for her dowry. But she recognized the hour, and so she washed his feet ahead of his burial. Now, Jesus' death is obviously on his mind. If you've read the Gospel of John, he's been talking about his death that's looming, and that's where he turns. Now, I admit this is a difficult verse to interpret. Why does he say, "so that she may keep it for the day of my burial"? Honestly, I'm not sure. I'm not sure. I've read a bunch of commentators, but I think what he's saying is that she had originally kept it for the day of his burial, but had decided to act on this occasion. I think she knows what's coming. I think she knows that he is going to die. And she says that this is the time to express her devotion and amazement and gratitude to Jesus. It is Judas who completely misses that. And then Jesus actually quotes from Deuteronomy 15, verse 11, where it says, "For there shall never cease to be poor in the land. Therefore I command you," it says in the rest of that passage, "therefore I command you, you shall open your hand to your brother, to the needy, and to the poor in your land." So Jesus is not opposed to giving to the poor. Unfortunately, sometimes this passage has been used to say that we should not really focus on giving to the poor. That's not what Jesus is saying. He says rather that Judas and the world have their priorities set on the wrong thing. But Mary has her priorities set on the right thing, the supreme thing, Jesus Christ. And it is only when our hearts are really filled with the rich and wonderful grace of Jesus that we can begin to give, even out of our poverty, even out of our need. And that's the logic we see in Paul's letter in 2 Corinthians. He says, you know the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, he gave to you. And he says, only then will you flow with a wealth of generosity towards others in your life. Not a forced generosity, but a sincere generosity. Our reading this morning, just before Jesus enters in Jerusalem, tells us that in the midst of all this hubbub, the people are coming to Jerusalem to celebrate. And in verses 9 to 11, it tells us there's a large crowd that's beginning to take a touristic curiosity in Jesus and in Lazarus. And of course, Lazarus himself is a star witness for Jesus. And we're told that he too is now a target for the Pharisees, that he too will face the threat of persecution and death because he's been so closely identified with Jesus. And I think this is also true of you and I and of Mary. That no sooner than we begin to smell like Jesus, his life and his fragrance, people take notice. And we will also begin to share in his sufferings. This is a good test for our discipleship. Do people notice that we are Christians? And so the invitation this morning is come and suffer with Jesus, because this will allow you to exude a better fragrance for Jesus Christ. Let his death be yours in order that you may be alive with him and one day forever rise with him. As we close our time together, we have a choice to reflect upon prayerfully: devotion or deceit, delight or decay. We have the opportunity, as Paul says, to spread the fragrance of the knowledge of Jesus everywhere we go. He says, for you are the aroma of Christ among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. To one, a fragrance from death to death. To the other, a fragrance from life to life. Let me leave you before we pray with the words of Robert Murray McShane. Maybe take these words with you into the season of Lent as you fix your eyes on Jesus' atoning death for you. He says, learn much of the Lord Jesus. He is altogether lovely. Such infinite majesty, and yet such meekness and grace, and all for sinners. Do you feel your sin this morning? This is for you. Such infinite majesty, and yet such meekness and grace. Jesus is drawn to you, even in your sin. For every look at yourself, though, take 10 looks at Christ. Live much in the smiles of God. Bask in his beams. Feel his all-seeing eye settled on you, not in anger, but in love. And rest in his almighty arms. Let your soul be filled with a heart-ravishing sense of the sweetness and excellency of Jesus Christ and all that he is for you. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, you are infinitely worthy. And we ask this morning that you would be truly precious in our sights, that we would love you and want to spread the fragrance of you in our homes and in our families and in our workplaces and to our neighbors, that, Lord, indeed, by your Spirit working in us, not something that we manufacture, by your Spirit working in us, we would begin to smell like Christ and his aroma would just follow us. Thank you, Jesus, for your gospel. Thank you for you, for who you are, for your death and resurrection. Oh, Lord, we marvel at who you are and what you have done. We give you thanks now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Shall we pray? Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We come before you, Father, on this Sunday morning to thank you for your mercy and your grace. Dear Lord, once again, you have blessed us with a Sunday in which you could worship you together with our church family. But Father, as we stand here and sit here and are thankful to you, make us also think of what's happening to your children in the rest of the world. The war going on in Ukraine and Russia. The war going on in Israel. The terrible tragedy in Haiti. Father, and there are so many of your children being persecuted. And if we keep that as background, then we can be even so much more thankful for being here this morning, to hear about our precious Savior, to sit in a warm church, looking forward to a meal. Father, it is a wonderful thing to get together with each other and to sing your praise, to listen and find comfort in your word. You are an awesome God. Show us your ways, O God, and teach us your paths. Guide us in your truth and continue to teach us. For you are our God and our Savior. We thank you for that wonderful message this morning. We thank you for New City Church, and for their lending us Pastor Phil this morning. So we pray for him and for his family. We pray for Pastor Greg and Lindy and their family, and pray that you'll bless them in their work. Father, will you continue to watch over Blessings Christian Church and the Streetlight Church community whom we so care for? Father, as well as all those who teach your word in truth all over this world of yours. Guide and direct all who govern your church. Please, Father, continue to provide men who are willing and able to serve as leaders in your church. Soon we'll enter into a time of election of new office bearers, and we pray that you'll prepare godly men. Open their hearts and minds to serve you with gladness in an office in your church. Bless all the men and women that serve your church in various different capacities. Please provide them with much wisdom. Father, our Blessings Church here is part of a neighborhood with a large variety of cultures and religions. And we know that many of our neighbors do not know you as Savior. Help us to reach out to our neighbors, whatever race, religion, language. Help us to do so in love. May we never be ashamed of the gospel. For you yourself have told us that your glorious gospel is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes. Father, we thank you for all our fellow believers. And we thank you for this day of worship and fellowship. We praise you. And once again ask for forgiveness. For so often and so easily we praise ourselves. We start to think that perhaps we're just a bit better than our neighbors. Make us realize that everyone, each of us, all of us need your undeserved grace. Remind us that salvation comes only through faith in Jesus Christ. Teach us to see others as better than ourselves. Teach us to seek unity of faith with all those who confess your name in truth. Help us to honor you in every way, and then also to love our neighbors as ourselves. Father, we pray for those who have forgotten to honor you with their first fruits. And we ask that you'll be merciful to them and remind them of the story we just heard, of the preciousness of Jesus, of the value of putting also our monetary things away for you. Father, will you hear us as we bring before you our worries and our cares? We know that you've told us to be joyful always. Father, sometimes we go through difficult times, and it's difficult to be joyful, but we pray that you help us to give thanks in all circumstances. Teach us to look to you for our real joy. Father, we pray for those who mourn. Life is fragile. Life is often difficult. Today we remember the Williams family, as Barrington Williams' father passed away this week. Father, we pray for the family. We ask for comfort, the kind of comfort only you can provide. We also wish to remember the Bergsma family who buried a father and a grandfather last week. And we think of Olivia and Josh Slutz in our congregation, who, along with many other family members, will miss the presence of Rick. Father, we are reminded that we are but like grass of the field or even like flowers. We're here today and gone tomorrow. Our lives are so fragile. And so we pray for the Bartels family who are scheduled to bury Henry Bartels on Tuesday. Please comfort Nancy and all of the family as we think of Ben and Cindy and Matt and Sharon and our own congregation. Father, please comfort all those who are reminded at this time of losses in their own family at different times. Today, we also wish to remember all those who suffer from a mental illness or an addiction. These difficulties are often suffered alone, privately, or perhaps even in secret. Please bring comfort and healing. We pray for all those who suffer from different diseases and different disabilities. And we're thankful that you understand all of our difficulties and frustrations. You understand our anxiety. And once again, We pray for that peace, the peace that surpasses all understanding. And so we pray for healing and for blessings on the work of doctors and nurses and social workers. Father, we wish to bring before you the couples that struggle in their marriages. And we pray for guidance. Father, we ask that in those cases that there'd be repentance and forgiveness as required. Today we want to remember Emma Vandervelde and her husband Mike and their children. Father, as they grapple with Emma's cancer and the harsh treatments, and we pray for patience during these treatments. And we pray that they may be effective. We want to remember Nancy Elgersma. We want to thank you for her amazing recovery so far. But also ask for patience during the extended rehabilitation road that's still ahead of her. We think of Peter De Bruin and his continued compromises after his double lung transplant. We also wish to rejoice and give you thanks for your continued blessings. For the amazing truth that we can even call you Father, because your son was willing to call us siblings. The amazing future you have promised and prepared for us and all your children. But dear Father, as we rejoice in the thought of this amazing future, we also pray for our children and for all those who did receive this sign and seal of your promise, but have lost their way. Please comfort parents whose children have been deceived. Please drag them back. Remind them of their baptism and the promises that reach far beyond this life. Father, remind us of the power of prayer as we pray and plead for the mercy that we all, including our wayward children, need so desperately. Teach us as well, Father, to continue praying in all circumstances that your will be done. Father, have mercy on all of us. None of us deserve your grace. None of us are worthy. Only one was ever found worthy. Please view us all as washed by our worthy Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We pray for all of us here. Help us in the coming week to seek all our comfort in you alone, to continue to fight sin. Father, give us your Holy Spirit. Help us to live by faith and not by sight. And we pray that your Spirit may conclude our prayer and bring before you and remember all that we may have forgotten or failed to mention, that he may do that with the groans that will be heard and honored by you. All of this we ask in the name of our infinitely precious Savior. Amen. We've come to a time of giving, the offertory. The offertory is not for our budget or the operational expenses, but for the deacons who are collecting for the needs in the congregation and in our neighborhood, as well as for our friends at Christians Against Poverty. Further information about the work done by this organization will be projected on the screen. You can give electronically using deacons@blessinghamilton.ca, or if you prefer, there are two black boxes located on the back wall of the sanctuary for those who would prefer to donate via cash or check at the conclusion of this service, as we no longer pass bags through the church service, through the sanctuary. Guests are, of course, welcome to participate, but please don't feel any obligation. We're just happy to have you here. We'll now have a short musical interlude so we can think about the offering, and following that by a blessing of the Lord for all of us, pronounced by Pastor Phil.
I'm not sure if it is your custom to stand for the benediction, but I invite you to do so. Our benediction this morning is from Numbers chapter 6, the Aaronic blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Go in the peace of Christ. Amen.
And servants, hosts of heaven, all creation, praise the name of the Lord, night and morning, sing his glory now and forevermore. Earthly kingdoms, all dominions, yeah.